Thank you, Liz. Hi, everybody. Glad to be here today talking about clinical interviewing guidelines, a topic near and dear to my heart. I started doing clinical interviewing, gosh, probably over 20 years ago, but I don't want people to start doing the math, so let's just get started. So let's look at what our outline is for today and the goals of our training. Basically, we're going to be going over some of the more important aspects of clinical interviewing. Number one, building rapport, really building that relationship with the participant, maintaining confidentiality in the procedures that you do, ensuring your safety and the safety of your participants, and then we're going to really drill down into more specific interviewing techniques for different types of interviews, specifically the structured types of interviews, semi-structured interviews, and more in-depth or qualitative interviews. And really our goal for this webinar is to promote good clinical interviewing practices that really facilitate reliable and valid data collection, because that's our goal in the CTN. One of our goals is to produce the most reliable and valid data possible, and by ensuring good interviewing techniques, we can maximize our ability to reach that goal. So we're going to do a poll and see who we've got on the line. And Liz, are you going to run those polls?
I sure will, Gloria. Let's move over to the poll right now.
All right, so just to get a sense of who's on the call, what is your experience with clinical interviewing? And everybody seems to be pretty facile in using the poll, so you're going to click the color that represents the length of time that you've been doing clinical interviewing. People, so we still have some people who haven't quite voted yet, but we will just leave this up for another 10 seconds. Now we can go ahead and close the poll. So we've got about half of the people on the call of those who voted are pretty experienced clinical interviewers. That's great. So if you've got information to share, please bring it on. And about a fifth of you, almost a quarter of you, have been interviewing for less than a year, and you're really in the right place. This is this kind of information is hopefully going to lead to your continued success as a clinical interviewer. And then we've got some folks in the middle, and again, any experiences you have to share, please feel free, and our operator will let you know how to indicate when you have a question or a comment. Okay, great. So we'll go back to the presentation. Thank you. All right, so what are some of the hot topics in substance abuse treatment interviewing that we talk about with our clients? Well, of course, we talk about drugs, sex, drinking, relationship problems, abuse, and not substance abuse here, also trauma and all kinds of physical problems, and money. So these are some of the main questions that we're interested in when we do substance abuse research. Now, these are topics that people typically don't talk about in their everyday lives, and they come into our offices often maybe the second or third time they've ever met us in their lives, and we start asking them about all of these hot topics. So we really want to be sensitive to the fact that these are difficult issues for people to talk about. Yes, they're in substance abuse treatment. Yes, they've probably been asked a lot of these questions a lot of times, and we can come in with that attitude, but I think we need to also appreciate that these are not always easy things to talk about and really address and be ready to be focused on the comfort of our participants and making sure they feel safe enough to discuss these important issues with us. And that's why it's really important to focus on building rapport. And so how do you build rapport? How do you build a relationship with a participant? Well, you want to be friendly, not overly friendly. We'll talk about boundaries as we move through the conference. But you want to be friendly. You want to be unbiased and make sure that your verbal and nonverbal language are as neutral as possible. You want to practice good listening skills, and we'll get into more detail on that, and to be empathic. And all of these we're going to talk about in a little bit more detail. So how can you be friendly and have a positive attitude with a participant? Well, you want to be warm with a person. You want to be open, personable. You still want to be professional. Make sure that you have your professional boundaries. And also be supportive and be attentive to what the participant is going through and what their responses are. So one way to build rapport, and we do this in almost all of the interviews that we conduct in the CTN, is we really set the tone with an introduction to the interview. And this can be a more general introduction to the interview process, and also it can be a specific introduction to each interview that you're conducting with a participant. So if you're doing an ASI, an RBS, which is the risk behavior scale for sex behaviors, a timeline follow-back. Each of those have some introductory comments to preface what the interview is about and the kinds of responses you're looking from the participant, because you want to prepare them and let them know what's coming next. So you're setting the tone with the introduction, explaining the purpose, emphasizing the participant's participation and the value of their participation, and addressing any interview-specific issues. So if there's a type of rating scale you'll be using, you would explain this here. And again, most of our interviews have these statements that are built in. If they don't, then part of your training is usually to develop something that you can use prior to conducting the interview. But it really does help to set the tone, establish good transitions, and make sure that the participant is comfortable. So another topic that's important in building rapport and making a participant comfortable is to know your own biases. And really, when you're doing interviewing, your self-awareness is key. Everyone has biases about everything in life, right? But definitely when we're coming to substance abuse treatment programs and dealing with people with either long-standing or short-term or whatever kinds of problems with substance abuse, with illegal behaviors, there are biases that go along with that. And that's just a natural part of life, and that's fine. But we really want to be aware of what our biases are. And understand our reactions and assumptions before we go into an interviewing situation. So as you're becoming aware of that, it's one of the reasons why we really want to limit self-disclosure, because self-disclosures could really betray some of the biases that we have to a participant. And most participants do like to please. If they're participating in the research, sure, they're getting some probable monetary value from doing so, but these are people who you typically like to please. So if you have a certain attitude that's being conveyed, this could influence a participant's response. So we want to be as neutral and unbiased as possible. So hopefully you have a paper and pencil handy, something that you can write some things, some words down with. And, I'm a psychologist by background, and I love things like word association from my more psychoanalytic training days way back when. So we're going to do a little word association test, and I'm not going to ask anybody to call out the words that they're associating, so this is going to be a free association, but just on paper that you can do privately. So what are the first things that come to mind when you see the word addiction? And just write down whatever comes to the top of your head. Take 10 seconds to do that. Heroin. Right, the first things that pop into your mind. AIDS. Now take a look at what you've written down. And can you detect any biases in the words that you wrote, in your responses, in your first reactions, in your associations to the terms addiction, heroin, and AIDS? There probably are. And whatever they are, again, we just want to make sure that we know what they are and are ready to keep them in check as we are talking to participants and trying to get the most reliable and valid data that we can. So how are some ways that we can avoid bias? Certainly by this self-awareness that we've been talking about. But also, and we'll come back to this quite a few times, we're going to want to ask open-ended questions, okay? Questions that don't require a yes or no answer. Questions that facilitate people's responding in however way they see fit. Questions that don't lead, questions that are open-ended. We want to ask follow-up questions that use the participant's own words. It's always a really effective way of getting more information. If you're unclear about something and somebody says, I wasn't feeling well. You weren't feeling well? Can you tell me more about that? Okay, so I've used the participant's own words and I've asked an open-ended question. Again, you want to remain neutral, and that's verbally and non-verbally. 60%, and that might not be the exact, but around 60%, even more, of our communication is nonverbal communication. And right now, we're on a webinar, so we're not able to see each other and our communication, but when you're sitting in an interviewing situation, and usually, right, you're in a small room, one-on-one, what you're portraying with your body, with your legs, with the way that you're sitting can communicate a lot, so it's something to be aware of. And also, as I mentioned, you want to avoid leading questions. Something like, don't you think that was excessive when somebody tells you they drank a case of beer the night before? Probably not the right question to ask, right? A bit of a leading question. So in the spirit of thinking about the right kinds of questions to ask, let's do another poll. All right, which one of the following is an open-ended question? The red one, were you drinking a six-pack? Did that make you feel sick? Did you drink the whole bottle of wine? Or how much cocaine were you using at the time? Which one of these is an open-ended question? And we'll give another 5 seconds for people to log in their votes. And why don't we show the results?
Leave the polls open for people to.
So overwhelmingly, are the polls still open or are people seeing the results?
I'm going to go ahead and close it. It looks like the input has stopped.
Okay. All right, and basically we have the overwhelming response to the green question, which is correct, which is the open-ended question, how much more cocaine were you using at that time? So that is the more open-ended response. Did that make you feel sick? That's a yes or no question. Did it make you feel sick, yes or no? how sick did you feel? That's an open-ended question. Somebody says, I was feeling sick. How sick did you feel? That's an open-ended question. You're eliciting more information and not getting a yes-no response. Do we have another poll after this one?
Next question talks about safety, yeah.
Okay, so that's later. Okay, why don't we see if anybody has any questions about this right now? If so, what is the procedure for asking a question?
Okay, if you do have a question over the phone lines today, you may do signal by pressing star, then 1 on your telephone keypad at this time, or if you have a comment. If you're using a speakerphone, please make sure your mute function is turned off to allow your signal to reach our equipment. Proceed in the order that you signal us, and we'll take as many questions as time permits. Once again, if you have a question or a comment at this time, simply press star, then 1 on your touch-tone telephone.
All right, so does anybody have any questions about open-ended questions or about anything we've talked about so far? Any questions or comments? And we'll do this, open up the lines. Periodically throughout the webinar.
There are no questions that have been signaled or comments at this time.
Okay, thank you. So let's move ahead. This is one of my favorite quotes that I heard recently. The reason why we have two ears and only one mouth is that we may listen the more and talk the less. It's an ancient wisdom. And what I've heard more recently is you have two ears and one mouth, use them proportionally. And basically here we're talking about the importance of good listening and effective listening. And as an interviewer, yes, recording data is your main purpose, but to do that you have to be a really good listener. So how can we become the most effective listeners we can be? Well, first of all, we have to realize that listening is an active process. It's not just sitting there absorbing information. There are questions that we can ask to be better listeners. There are rephrasing that we can do to be better listeners. It is an active process. So as people are, as the respondent is answering your questions, you should be asking yourself questions. Again, an active process. You're always thinking as you're interviewing. Is it clear what the person means? When they say, I felt sick, what does that mean? Is the information they're giving you relevant to the question? It might sound really good, but they may not be answering your question. You have to really know the intent of the question. We'll talk more about that in order to know whether or not it's relevant. Is their answer complete? Are they giving you all the information you need to code an answer, to collect the data? What does the tone of voice mean? And we come back here to the nonverbal cues in communication. So we want to be listening to the way a person is speaking to us. And then we want to be thinking, okay, should I interrupt to probe? Should I ask another question right now? Or should I wait and let the person flesh it out a little bit more themselves before I stop and probe? And this is going to really depend upon whether you're doing a more structured interview, a semi-structured interview, which direction the participant's going. But these are the kinds of questions you want to be asking yourself as the participant is responding to the questions. So more pointers on listening. Don't assume answers or understanding. So when somebody says they're sick or they say just a little, what do those things mean? Code it, again, only if it meets the intent of the question. And that's really important to really know your interview, know what it's asking, know what the purpose of the question is. So if you're doing a DSM-4 interview, the intent of the question is going to be to see if the person meets that diagnostic criterion. So you have to be really clear on the criterion as you're asking the question. Again, listening carefully is just as important as reading the questions. And also remembering what people tell you as you go on in the interview. So we do ask, typically in CTN studies, we have a battery of assessments, right? We'll have a list of 5, 10 different assessments. And sometimes the questions overlap, and certainly the areas of interest overlap. So as you're asking somebody about their substance use history, and maybe you're doing the timeline follow back, and you're asking them about their use in the last 30 days, and they tell you that, yeah, they were drinking a lot on that Friday, and in fact, that was the day that they ended up missing work, and they were so hungover, they didn't call in sick for work, and I really got in trouble with my boss. Well, that's the kind of information you want to file away, because later, if you're asking about some kind of impairment related to their substance use, you've already gotten that information, and you're going to want to confirm that when it comes up in a later interview. So always be attuned to what a person is saying, and by knowing your assessment battery very well, by knowing the questions you are asking and that you are going to ask, you're able to make it flow better and have more valid information by recalling and working with the participant who is giving you information and then being able to reflect it back at the appropriate time. So really important to be paying attention on many different levels as we're doing these interviews. So the last way of building rapport, and we're talking about building a relationship and being warm and friendly and being a good listener, the other way is to be empathic. And what is empathy? Well, empathy, this is the dictionary definition, the intellectual identification with or vicarious experiencing of the feelings, thoughts, or attitudes of another. And it is the feelings, thoughts, or attitudes. It's all three of those things. So you're identifying with what people are telling you, not only the content of what they're saying, but also kind of the feeling behind it and what thinking might be going along with it. And when you can take a more empathic stance to what a person is saying, you end up building better rapport with them. So empathy is something that we can work on building and improving, and a couple of very specific ways to do that are, one, using the person's language, like we were talking about before. So if somebody says, I was freaking out, well, when you said that you were freaking out, what exactly was going on? So you're, again, using their language to get into more of their experience. And then, again, the nonverbal cues are really essential. Looking at a person's body language, making sure that you're making eye contact. If somebody starts telling you something and they kind of look away, they're getting uncomfortable, you might want to comment, is something making you uncomfortable? Are you feeling uncomfortable right now? Something like that. I know those are too closed-ended questions, but that's okay sometimes. But just to attend to those things as well, to really monitor how the participant is doing to maintain that relationship to really for the benefit of getting the best information that we can. So another important part of being a clinical interviewer is to maintain good boundaries. And you really need to know your role. You're all, either you're on this call because you're a clinical interviewer or you've been an interviewer. We're all working on these trials, collecting data. Some of you may also be clinicians. Who are functioning in a research role. But by and large, your role as an interviewer is very different from your role as a clinician, because as an interviewer, your main goal is to collect the data and to make sure that the participant is safe and comfortable. As a clinician, you're solving problems. And not that you don't solve problems as an interviewer, but there's only so much that you can do. And there have to be boundaries that you set. So people need to see a clinician. You need to know what to refer them or how to do that. We have different procedures at different clinics. So, but we want to make sure that as an interviewer, you're maintaining your boundary as somebody who is collecting data and making sure that you're referring to a clinician when need be. And we'll talk about more when those need be's come up. So you're going to listen empathically, but then you might have to redirect a conversation and encourage participants to discuss clinical issues with their counselor. If somebody starts talking to you about they're feeling depressed, and we'll talk a little bit about, if they're feeling so depressed they want to hurt themselves, that's a different situation. But if a participant is getting sidetracked, telling you a lot of stories about what's going on at the treatment program or what's going on in their lives or their relationships or how they're feeling, those are the kinds of things you really want to encourage them to talk about with their clinicians. That, you're here to get the information from them. You appreciate, I appreciate that you're under some stress, and I really encourage you to talk to your counselor about that. So being able to set those kinds of boundaries is doing yourself and the participant a big favor. But sometimes things can get a little awkward. And I'm sure if the lines were open, we would hear tremendous amounts of giggling. I love that cartoon. Thank you, Liz. So we've got a few questions here that a participant might ask you, and some of you might have had an experience like this, where a participant might ask you a pointed question that's a little awkward, and in the service of maintaining your professional boundaries, you need to formulate a response to any of these questions that could be asked at any time that are going to be helpful to the participant and, again, maintaining those good interviewing boundaries. So we have a few different questions here. Does anybody want to take a stab at how they might respond to if a participant asks, do you have a boyfriend or do you have a girlfriend? What might you say? And so here, again, you would do *1 to indicate that you'd like to answer.
We have Autumn.
Okay.
Hi, this is Autumn.
Hi, Autumn.
Generally, if someone asks me something like that, I might say, I understand that you're curious about me, but my personal rule is that I never discuss my outside life with participants or anyone at work. So let's just get back to what we were doing while you're here.
Okay, great. I like that. My personal rule. And you're modeling, that's a nice modeling behavior of, we all have our personal rules, and this is mine. That's a great one.
Thank you.
Okay, anyone else have a response to do you have a boyfriend or do you have a girlfriend?
We go to Denise Allen.
Okay. Hi, Denise.
Denise, your line's open.
Hello.
Hi. How would you respond, Denise?
Again, Denise, your line is open. Please make sure your phone is off of mute.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay. I would respond to that in a way that would maintain confidence with the patient, but at the same time by letting them know that this is a personal interview and we should maintain that and keep that respect with one another. So I would probably say something like that's a personal opinion and that's a personal subject and I like to keep it that way and let's just stick with the questions that we have at hand.
Okay, so similar to what Autumn said, to really emphasize that we're here to, to talk about, to do this interview. This is a personal matter that I, like Autumn had said, my rule is I don't discuss things like this.
Right.
At work. And I like that that's that broad, at work. And it doesn't matter if you're my coworker or you're a person sitting in the office who I'm interviewing. So something like that. So again, maintaining that clear boundary while, also maintaining a good relationship with the participant. And that's why these are awkward questions, because you don't want to put the person off, but you do need to maintain the boundary. Okay, thank you. Does anybody else have a response to that, or can we move on? We move on to the next. Clayton?
There are no other questions or comments regarding that question coming in the queue.
Thank you. Okay, so the next one. Are you in recovery? How might you respond to that? Are you in recovery?
You can press *1 if you have a question or a comment. We have Davina Jones.
Great. Hi, Davina.
Hi. You know, it's kind of an interesting question. Because of the people that we are interviewing and, you know, worked in the field for about 10 years now, there is a little comfort in them speaking to somebody if they know they're in recovery. However, you know, I also see that when it comes to this, you really want to maintain your confidentiality. So I may or may not, you know, reveal that information to them, or would probably do as the others had said on the previous question and just remind them that this is a professional interview and that I unfortunately need to keep information separate from theirs or you know, whatnot.
Yeah, and, you know, I think depending upon the situation on the person sitting there, you could even say, you know, I understand that sometimes people want to know that because they feel like, you know, some people feel like they could relate better to somebody who might be in recovery, or some people feel they might relate better to somebody who's not in recovery.
Right.
But for our purposes here, I think, you know, it's more important, I think, to, you know, focus on the interview and, you know, to get our questions answered and move on with our with the data collection or something. So, okay, great. Thank you. Anyone else?
No other cues have come up.
Okay, so here's one, and I'm going to say it with some feeling. How much longer is this going to take?
Again, if you have a comment about that, go ahead and press star one.
How might you respond to that?
We'll go to Christy Thomas.
Right.
Hi, Gloria.
Hi, Christy.
So I guess you sort of gave me a little bit of clue in how you said that, but I guess my first thought would be it sort of depends on how that question is said. So hopefully, you know, I would have told the person at the start of the visit how long that particular interview is going to take, how long they're going to be with us today. And if I didn't, you know, and I suspect it's just information gathering, I might just sort of say, you know, or this is going to take approximately another, you know, 2 hours or 1 hour, maybe try to overestimate a little bit just so that when we get done a little earlier, they're pleasantly surprised. But if it's more about a person being tired or annoyed or just can't wait for it to be over, I think my response would really depend on how well I know the participant or the circumstances. I really try to kind of assess where they are with maybe the verbal, nonverbal cues.
Yeah.
I might be funny and flip in my response just if I knew that person really well and say, you know, well, I plan to keep you here until tomorrow. Is that going to be a problem? And then hopefully maybe with a little chuckle, we really clarify. But if it's an issue of, you know, I just got to go, this is taking way too long, I would probably follow up with a question about how they're doing, whether we need to take a break or what's going on, or do we need to stop for a while, or, you know, so it just, I guess, depends on the participant and the context in which they're saying that.
Yeah, yeah, that's great. So I think you made a lot of important points, and one of them is the importance of that introduction and preparation of the participant for the interview, and that wasn't on the slide about preparation. But you always, and you know, we usually have in our consent forms how long an assessment is going to take, but a lot of times we do the consent many days before we do the interview, or sometimes it's months before we do another interview since we've done the consent. And so we want to remind the participant when they get here, so today this is going to take about 2 hours, and make sure that they have the time to do that. And then if you are, you know, somebody who can offer breaks, you know, maybe a cup of coffee or a piece of candy in your office, and I think you made another great point about that nonverbal behavior. So I did say, I asked that question with a certain tone of voice, like I was getting kind of really tired and whiny. And those are the kinds of nonverbal cues that you want to be attentive to. So thanks for that, those answers, Christy.
We did have also Davina Jones queue up.
Great.
Oh, hi there. This is another one, too, and I think you actually just kind of answered it how I would. Yeah, I realize that this interview is kind of taking a little bit of time. We do have so many forms left to go. It's probably going to take us about this much time, and maybe offer them a break if they're needing to stretch their legs or whatever.
Yeah.
If it's a matter of that they have a time constraint, the same sort of thing, just try and reassure them that we'll get through it as quickly as possible and go from there.
Yeah, because I think we're also very attuned as interviewers to, once we've got the person in front of us, we want to collect that data. we want to make sure we get everything we can once we have them, because actually we were on a call for the 44th protocol yesterday, and maybe it was Tuesday, and Amy Campbell said, because you never know if you're going to see that person again when they walk out your door. You just don't know if you'll ever see them again. So we have this tendency to want to make sure that we keep the person there and collect all the data we can. That's certainly what we want to do. That's our goal, is to get that done. But we also need to be attentive to how that participant is doing and try to work with them to keep them engaged and involved and comfortable for, you know, the extent that we can. Okay, anybody else in the queue for that one?
And no one else is queued up.
All right, and then the last one on the slide, do you want to meet for coffee later? What might you say to that question?
We have Scott Provost.
Great. Hi, Scott.
Hi. This is another kind of tricky one, but I think it's closer to the first two in terms of, like, boundary setting. And, again, I think it depends on maybe at what point in the interview the question is raised, before or near the end or even in the middle. And then it also could be some, you know, gender dynamics with this question.
Yeah.
But I do the same kind of things as in the first two questions, kind of be respectful and polite, but set a firm boundary. Something like, you know, that's a kind offer, but, you know, we're here to focus on the research interview. If you need to discuss anything more offline, this might be something to discuss with your clinician or counselor, and just really set the boundary and make it pretty crystal clear.
Yeah, exactly. And I like that. You know, that's a kind offer, so you're being empathic, but this is a research interview, and we need to focus on that, giving them the facts, and then also making that, connection to, if you have things that you want to talk about more, definitely talk to your counselor about that. That would be the place to go.
This question is also like ones where if a participant tries to offer you a gift, to me it's the same kind of thing. It's always a tricky one because it can come out of nowhere, a surprise.
Yeah. Right, or somebody shows up at your office with a cup of coffee for you, kind of a thing, or offers a gift. And basically, you know, there's a fine line that you don't want to alienate the person, but you want to make sure that you keep that boundary. Okay, great.
We also had Thomas Hill queue up.
Okay. Hi, Thomas.
Hi. I think that is even more tricky than that, because it's always been a rule of thumb, and everything that I've ever heard working in the field is that this is a big no-no here. And if you're receptive on any level, or sound receptive on any level, you could really set a whole snowball rolling. So I think it's really important to, right from the get-go, set with the client that, yes, that is a kind thing to ask, but this is not something that is okay for us to do.
Right. So being really clear about that from the get-go. Yeah.
Right.
Absolutely. Thank you for adding that. All right. Anyone else?
No one else at this time.
All right. So we're gonna close the phone lines and move on. So how about when the participant is maintaining their boundaries and they're like, no, I really don't want to do this anymore, or no, I'm not going to answer that question. So where is that coming from, and what can you do about it? Well, a lot of times people say no because they're uncomfortable with the question. So like the hot topics that I put up at the very beginning, there may be some areas that a person just does not want to talk to you about. They're just not comfortable with a certain question. And we tell participants at the beginning, if there's anything that you feel uncomfortable with and you don't want to answer, you certainly don't have to. That is their right, because they're voluntary participants. And sometimes people are uncomfortable and they just say no. Other times they might feel overwhelmed, that things are, you know, that maybe we've asked too many questions that are pushing buttons, or, you know, the the interview process has gone on too long, or the, you know, they're in a particularly fragile state, and that could lead to people not wanting to participate anymore, or you know, wanting to stop an interview, or they just prefer not to answer for whatever reason, or they want to discontinue participation in the study altogether. So any of these could come up. And so how do we deal with participants saying no? Well, as always, we always want to go back to being understanding and respectful and empathic and really trying to get to the bottom of what the problem is and why a person is saying no. And we can normalize their response. A lot of people are uncomfortable answering these questions. These can be very difficult questions to ask. Or, you know, sometimes it is a hassle getting to the clinic twice a week to give a urine. So you want to be respectful of that and normalize that response that a person is having. And then at that point, really try to figure out if there might be solutions to a problem. So maybe they're having a hassle coming in because there are some issues that they're having around transportation. You know, their car broke down, there's not sufficient public transportation, they're having monetary issues, whatever. Maybe there's a problem that you can help them solve to get to the clinic if it's something more logistic. Maybe there's some kind of car service you could provide. But you really need to understand where the response is coming from to possibly provide a solution. If a person is really adamant about stopping, which again, we have to be respectful of that, if you could just get part of the data that we're looking for, that's what you have to do. And then again, if people really just say, no, I just don't want to do this anymore, maybe you could ask if they might be willing to talk to you later. I understand that you're really not interested in doing this right now. Could I call you next week and see if you might be ready to come back? Or could I call you in a month? And again, being specific about when you might contact them and how to get their permission to try to get them back in. So we want to use as many strategies as we can to continue to have a good engagement with the participants and get them back in and continuing to participate. And to do that, I think good listening and good problem solving are all going to work in our favor in doing the best that we can around that. And then there are those times where no is no and people are done, and so be it. All right, so now we're going to move on to issues of confidentiality and privacy. And everybody who's on this call, I'm sure, has taken all of their good research practice and human subjects protection, and you're all incredibly well-versed in maintaining participant confidentiality. But it is such an important topic, we're going to talk about it again, because you just can't do enough to protect people's confidentiality. And really, we're talking here about in an interviewing situation. So really on a day-to-day basis, what can we do to protect a participant's confidentiality? And we all know that we need to keep names separate from research data. We want to keep our desk clear. I mean, I've seen situations where people leave files on their desk, and then it becomes apparent what the data, you know, somebody could just look at the file and start looking at data. So you want to keep your desk clear. Especially you've got an interview or an interviewee coming in, you don't leave anything out that could violate somebody else's confidentiality. As always, you want to store files in locked cabinets. You want to have good phone habits. So when you're answering the phone, when you're making follow-up calls, when you're talking to other contacts, you want to make sure that you're still protecting a person's confidentiality. Make sure that your phone line doesn't give away where you're calling from. You know, sometimes when you put somebody on hold, some programs have, and you know, as a research staff, you may not be aware of this all the time, but a clinical program might have, their hold their hold message could be about their program. And if you put like a potential contact or you know, locator contact on hold and they start hearing that information, well, you're really violating confidentiality because now the contact person knows that you're calling from a substance abuse treatment program about the participant. So these little, you know, these are very subtle ways that confidentiality can be breached, and we need to think those through every step of the way. And one that I've seen happen more times than I care to acknowledge is, you know, when people are just walking down the hall and talking about studies or talking about patients. I mean, how many times have you been in a hospital and a doctor is talking to somebody about a patient? And, you know, if you really know who's in the hospital, you can kind of figure out who it is. I think we've become more attuned to that, but, you know, if you're standing at somebody's doorway and you're chatting, somebody else could be standing outside or walking by and hear you say something that could identify somebody else. So just be really aware of all of those places where we need to be vigilant about protecting people's confidentiality. Also, to address confidentiality before doing an interview as part of those preparatory remarks, you're reminding people that their answers are confidential, reminding them of the voluntary nature of the interview. They can refuse to answer questions. That acknowledgement and those reminders can really free people up to feel more comfortable to disclose the information that we're asking. Of course, there are the exceptions to confidentiality. Any indication that somebody is going to harm themselves, the suicidal risk, and here we're talking about people who have intent and a plan that, you know, they've been thinking about it, that they have a gun, that they really don't see any, you know, any reason to continue living. Those kinds of disclosures should set up red flags, you know, all around you. You probably get some kind of knot in the pit of your stomach. Maybe you start to dissociate. I mean, who knows? Whatever your reaction might be, pay attention to those clues in yourself. If you start having a response to somebody that you don't typically have, and here's where we come back to the issue of self-awareness, those kinds of responses can be very informative. You know, the psychotherapists call that countertransference. Like, what is the feeling that gets evoked in sitting with somebody else? And if you know kind of what your feeling is sitting with people in general, then that awareness, then you can really start using yourself as a tool to realize if something is wrong. And I wouldn't use that so much in a regular clinical interviewing situation, but when you're talking about harm to self, harm to others, I think our own responses, and also just in the interviewing situation, I'll take that back, our own responses can be very informative to what's going on and maybe some different places we have to query or probe. So harm to self or harm to others, and the three main areas there are homicidal ideation, I'm going to kill somebody, and I had that situation when I was a clinical intern working in a employee health service and the substance abuse arm of the employee health service, and I had a guy come to talk to me, and he was intoxicated, and he was talking about if he loses his job, he was going to kill his boss and kill whoever else, and he had a gun in his locker, and I definitely had a different level of adrenaline flowing in me than I had ever had before in interacting with any patient ever, and so that was something that I had to go and deal with and find a supervisor, and security had to come. You know, those are the kinds of things, they don't happen often, but when they do, you have to be ready. So homicidal ideation, elder abuse, if you get a sense that somebody's taking advantage or hurting the elderly, that you are compelled and required to report, and child abuse. And again, these things are all laid out in the consent form. The person knows about them when they come in to participate. Often they forget, and you may need to remind them. So what's the basic take-home here is that you really have to be prepared. You have to know your local SOPs. What do you do if? And if you don't know what to do, then that's what you have to do when we end this call. You have to find out what you're supposed to do if any of those situations come up. And, you know, if this webinar does nothing else but instigate a conversation at your program, or make you go and revisit Some of those SOPs, make sure that you know what the procedures are. That would be, you know, a great takeaway from this webinar today. So you always want to be prepared. So this does kind of segue into interviewer and participant safety, because when we're talking about exceptions to confidentiality, we're talking about potential safety issues. So before we move into safety, does anybody have any questions or comments before we move along?
Again, that's star one if you have a question or a comment at this time. We did one queue up. We'll go to Maria Martinez.
Hi, this is Maria.
Hi, Maria.
Hi, how are you? I just wanted to make a comment because it's something that's not frequently talked about, and that is some of us that do interviewing live in the same catchment areas where some of our participants come from. And some of the things that I always tell the participants, you know, after I finish interviewing them, is that because they sometimes ask, oh, so confidentiality, if I see you out in the street, can I say hi to you? And I always tell them, you know, it's up to you. I never say hi to no one because I don't want, you know, so people might know where I work at, and I don't want nobody to say, you know, because you, because I'm pointing you out.
Yeah.
So if you see me, I might act like I'm not seeing you, but it's okay for you to come up to me and say hello, but I leave it, the ball in your court. It's up to you if you want to do it. And I will not feel disrespected or anything if you don't say hi. That's fine with me.
Oh, that's great, Maria. Thank you for bringing that up. And I like how you, you know, you proactively deal with that because it's true. You know, I mean, I lived in New York City, so I would run into people all over the place because it is. It's a small, congested area, so you would run into people. And to let them know you're not disrespecting them or ignoring them, but you're protecting their confidentiality.
Right.
Sure, if they want to say hi to you, sure, yeah, hi. Good to
see
you. You know?
I tell them all the time, every interview.
That's great. That's great. Thanks for that reminder. And you're right. It doesn't happen everywhere, but, you know, it certainly could happen. If you work at a medical center, you could run into somebody in the neighborhood around there or at the cafeteria or whatever.
Right.
Thank you for bringing that up.
We also have Davina Jones.
Go ahead, Davina.
One of the things that you and we were just talking about with the confidentiality is around the phones. And what we did actually a couple years ago, about 5-6 years ago, is we went to a designated cell phone.
Oh.
So that way they don't have to actually contact the agency. They can contact us directly. It's always manned. Either myself or the RA always has it, and it's only used for research.
That's great.
Yeah, it's actually made a big difference, especially if you have clients who do end up leaving treatment but still are wanting to participate in the study. They don't have that much guilt about having to contact us through the agency itself. So
right.
It's made a huge difference.
That's great. That's a great idea. Thanks for bringing that up. So having a designated cell phone just for the research. And you tell people, right? You tell them, what if you need to contact me, you're contacting me directly. You don't need to go through the treatment program.
Yeah, we post that number on our business cards and on our flyers. That way it just comes directly to us.
That's great. Any other good ideas like that? Or
yes, we have a couple of people in queue. Susan Brandow.
Go ahead, Susan.
Susan, your line is open. Please make sure your mute function is turned off.
Okay. Well, I had a comment. I just wondered, you didn't speak about having personal things in your office. You talked about client files, but I also found that not having personal photos, you know, of a husband or kids or things like that should also be there. So, and the other was just a question. It was more about the awkwardness, but I just wondered how you felt about actually touching someone, you know, in terms of empathy, you know, touching their shoulder or putting your hand on their hand, or do you just shy away from that?
I would say don't touch people. I'll just put that down as a rule of thumb.
Okay.
I would say don't touch people because I think you could show a lot of empathy and support without having to touch somebody.
Okay.
Absolutely. I was in private practice as a psychologist for 10 years. I don't think I ever touched anybody. maybe that's not exactly, you know, maybe that's not 100%. Maybe later in my practice I did, or, you know, whatever. But I think as a rule of thumb, you can express your empathy and concern and support in different ways. So the rule of thumb would be no physical contact. And I lost track of your first comment.
It was just about your own personal effects.
Oh, right, right. And again, I would also shy away from that because that also, I would shy away from that because that can perpetuate some bias, right? I mean, now you're showing a person your family values or, you know, whatever that could make them respond a different way because they want to please you.
Mm-hmm.
So I would say, if you know, again, keeping the space as neutral as possible. Often, I don't know what your situation is, but often these spaces are shared spaces anyway. So, you know, if you've got three or four research staff working in one office, it's probably better to just keep things kind of neutral with a nice flower or some potpourri. I don't know. Although some people are allergic. So, but those are two great questions. Thank you.
And we'll go to Cindy Gilligan.
Okay, this will be the last one because then we're going to move along. Cindy?
Hi, Gloria. I have a question which is a segue to the issue about touching.
Yeah.
In the studies that I have been involved in, I see participants for a long period of time, and I get to know them, they get to know me, and invariably there's always several people who ask for a hug. So it's not, you know, trying to extend sympathy or empathy. It's that they are actively asking, oh, I need a hug. Can you give me a hug? How do you thwart that with that?
You're talking about people that you've known for quite a while. And so what do you do? What have you done?
If it's a female participant, I don't. It's easier for me to give a hug.
Uh-huh.
But if it's a male participant, I've always been saved by like somebody coming in.
Saved by the
bell. It's not something that I have actually solved the problem, but and another issue is that my office is set up so that their seat or chair is located in one place, and my desk and chair is 3-4 feet away. Invariably, they will drag their chair, bring it to my desk, put their elbow on the desk and say, okay, so what did you want to know?
Uh-huh.
And a couple times that has happened, I've been saved by, I've had like coughing spells or something, and I said, you know, it's better if you stay over there because I don't know what I have and I don't want you getting it.
Yeah, yeah. Well, we'll talk a little bit about how you position things in your office in a minute. But going back to the hug situation, it's not that different than those first questions that we had talked about. So saying something like, you know, I appreciate, the warmth you're feeling toward me right now, but you know my personal policy is not to it's not to hug the people that I work with, and I hope you understand that.
And if they've been crying and telling me that this has happened, that's happened, and they're visibly in distress and upset, and then after we've spent some time and they feel better and they go, thank you so much, you've made me feel much better.
I think you could give a hug with your eyes.
Mm-hmm.
I think you can give a hug with your eyes and your face. I'm mm-hmm. doing it right now if you could see me.
Okay.
Your own personal comfort level has something to do here, but basically, I would shy away from any physical contact because like, Thomas was saying before, that just can become a real slippery slope.
Mm-hmm.
A real slippery slope. So, you want to make those boundaries clear. And if a person is in your office and they're really that distressed, maybe they need to go talk to their counselor.
Uh-huh.
Also, that they need that extra support. And so you're modeling for them that, and I'm not sure which studies that you're talking about, maybe it's a different context, but you're telling them, we're here to do this one task. And then this other task of grieving and relieving yourself of all of this distress, not so much, the task of the interview,
mm-hmm.
or the research interview. That's more the task of therapy, of treatment. And so you're going to want to redirect to the appropriate person. So it sounds like, you know, the work you do is really coming from your heart. And so you're going to connect with participants and, you know, really engage with them. But you're also going to want to be very aware of keeping those boundaries clear.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so with that, it's a good segue to interviewer and participant safety, because all of these things are pretty related. So how do you stay safe as an interviewer on-site in your office? So you were just talking about how your office is situated, and I would recommend, if at all possible, to situate your office in a way that you're sitting nearest the door. So oftentimes, you know, there's just so much you could do in small spaces, and I realize that interviewing spaces are sometimes, you know, the modified janitorial closet or whatever, where we're doing a lot of the work that we do. If there's any way that you can situate it so you're sitting closest to the door, so if something does happen, you can get out of the office first. You know, in the situation that you were just describing where there are multiple chairs, you might want to come around the other side of your desk so there's not something in between you and the participant. Again, I realize that's not always possible. It sounds like you might have enough room that is possible. And that then will prevent people from slumping on your desk and then also create a little more open space between you and the participant. And again, I totally realize that it depends on where you are. Also, for your safety, make sure that other people on site know that you're conducting an interview. Put a sign on the door, interview in progress. That's definitely helpful if your schedule is somewhere that people know. But make sure you're not in a room alone with the door closed and nobody knows you're there. Again, you want to make sure that you're safe. Be aware of a participant's body language. If somebody's looking really agitated, they're clenching their fists. Those are good signs that somebody is getting wound up, and you want to be very attentive to that. Always be ready to end an interview if you don't feel safe. This is where kind of keeping track and being aware of your own response as something's going on, like that time where the guy was telling me he had the gun in his locker. I was like, well, if you could just stay here, Mr. Brown, and I'll be right back. And like, I got somebody right away to make sure that he didn't leave the door, but I got out of there to find somebody to help me because it was no longer, it was no longer about getting this information from him. It was about making sure that everybody in the situation was safe. And again, listening to your instincts is really key. So what if you do interviews off-site? And many of us do, because to get follow-up data, sometimes people leave the clinic, we have to go off-site. If at all possible, do those interviews with another staff member. Go like the Girl Scouts, use the buddy system. Meet in a public place at all possible while also being aware of confidentiality. Make sure, just like on site, make sure that staff knows where you are. But here, more so, make sure that somebody has the address where you're going, when you're going to be there, when you're leaving. And in that vein, make sure you're checking in with people before and after you do the interview so that they know that things have gone well. And make sure that you have a cell phone, your identification, all your materials. I don't know, make sure your cell phone is charged, because when you have a cell phone and it's not charged, it doesn't do you any good, speaking from personal experience here. So you just want to be really prepared and aware of your own safety when doing any off-site interviews. So in the spirit of safety, we have another poll about safety situations. Which one of the following is the safest interviewer situation? Sitting farthest from the door in the interviewing room, conducting an interview in a participant's home, meeting a participant at a coffee shop, or conducting an interview at the clinic after hours. So take a few minutes, a few seconds. And last call for voting. Liz, do you want to reveal the results? All right. So our majority here acknowledges that meeting a participant at a coffee shop is the safest of these interviewer situations. The first one is a little bit of a trick question. You want to sit closest to the door, not farthest from the door in the interviewing room. And then you really don't want to conduct an interview at the clinic after hours unless other people are around. Okay. Thank you. Good job, you guys. You're all safety-minded. Safety first. So in the same vein, we want to make sure that our participants are safe. We talked about that in confidentiality. If people become emotionally distraught or agitated or angry, we want to talk to their clinician, or we want to encourage them to talk to their clinician, but sometimes we need to talk to the clinician also. We want to make sure the person is safe and doesn't leave the clinic until you've made a plan for follow-up or possible reporting, and this is specifically in the case of somebody who might be suicidal or somebody you find might be abusing a child or an elder. And again, back to knowing your local SOPs. And so I could, if you weren't on mute, I'm sure I could hear you all rustling through them right now. All right, so that's about it for safety and confidentiality. So any questions up to this point? Now we're going to move more into the specific interviewing guidelines for the different types of interviews. So any questions?
Once again, that's star one if you have a question or a comment at this time. And there are no questions. We did have one that just came in from Denise Allen.
Thank you. Hi, Denise.
Once again, Denise, your line is open. Please check your mute function.
Okay. Hi.
Hi.
I just have one question with regard to the touching. Interviewer and participant, would handshaking be appropriate, a handshake?
I think a handshake is okay. You know, if the, I don't usually initiate a handshake, but if somebody puts out their hand to shake your hand, I think it's okay to shake somebody's hand.
Okay. All right, that's all I had. Thank
yeah.
you.
Sure.
There are no other questions in queue at this time.
Great. All right, so let's move on. So we're going to talk about, as I mentioned before, structured interviews, semi-structured interviews, and qualitative or in-depth interviews. So we'll start with the most structured of them all, the structured interview. And with fully structured interviews, you read the questions exactly as they're written. Okay, they're fully structured. Fully structured. That means you read the questions as they're completely written. You follow the instructions to a T. There could be skip instructions and where you go from here to there. If this happens, then you do that. You got to follow the instructions. Like with all these interviews, you need to know the intent of the questions. And in fact, in fully structured interviews, it's a little trickier to get the information you need because you're constrained by the way that you can ask the questions. You can only ask neutral probes to elicit further information. And really, they're designed that so that we can get really consistent administration and that most anyone can administer them. You know, some semi-structured interviews requires people to have a certain level of clinical background and training to administer the interview. A fully structured interview, the assumption is because it's fully structured, there doesn't need to be clinical judgment. You can have most anybody with any type of level of basic training to conduct the interview, and that is a very useful feature, especially for the CTN, where we have people working all over the country in many different types of clinics with many different kinds of backgrounds. And that's the beauty of a fully structured interview is that we can put it in the hands of many different types of people, people with different backgrounds and education, and we can still get very good results. So some of you may be familiar with the, me, it's not the granddaddy, but that's what comes to my mind. The granddaddy of fully structured interviews in the CTN, which is the CD. And so it's more curiosity, but I'd like to get a poll of how many people, we have a poll about the CD. Are you a trained CD interviewer? Yes or no? This is a closed-ended question. All right, see now, 3-4 years ago in the CTN, probably would have been a little bit, we would have had a shift in our numbers, but let's see where we come up with. Still have some votes coming in. Give you another 5 seconds to vote, and then we'll close the poll. Looks like the voting's done. We close the poll and see the results. So we've got about one-third of the people on the call who care to admit that they've been trained as a CD interviewer, and we might even have some CD trainers on the line. And then about two-thirds have not been trained in the CD. So some of this may be new for you. For those who've been trained in the CD, you understand about fully structured interviews, and you may have some comments about them, and we'll look forward to hearing from you as we go through. So, but we'll go back to the slides. So there are a number of you who already know about the qualities of a fully structured interview. So there are a number of rules, and how do you ask the questions in a fully structured interview? As I mentioned before, you ask them exactly as they are written. And there's a couple of exceptions. Sometimes you need to change it to past or present, make some grammatical changes. That's okay. Also, some questions can be long. And the way you can deal with a long question is breaking up the question into a series of shorter questions. But again, using the exact wording of the instrument. Okay, but sometimes if you break them up into smaller questions, it helps people understand the questions better. Here we kind of get back to the issue that came up before about good listening, that you need to verify information that a person volunteers. So if somebody tells you that they were having trouble with their drinking or trouble at work because of their drinking, you can't just take that at face value. You need to confirm that, and often confirm it by asking the question again. And you might say to a participant, you might have answered this before, but I need to ask you the question exactly as it's written. Okay? So back to that theme, asking the question exactly as it's written. Read the entire question. Use the skip instructions. Emphasize key words. That's one way to deal with a fully structured interview. Sometimes people feel that they're very constrained by it and they're not able to ask the questions the way they'd like. Well, there are some times that you can emphasize a certain word. You know, so if you ask a person, how often did you have trouble in your relationship as a result of your drinking? And they say, yeah, I did, or something. Okay. How often? Okay, you would emphasize the words that will lead you to the response that you're looking for. There are lead-in statements in fully structured interviews. You would use those as you're asking the questions. And they're really kind of those introductory statements that orient people to what you're going to ask. But again, fully structured, so you're going to read those exactly as they're written on the form. Oftentimes, fully structured interviews have other materials related, like interview cards, places where people can look at the possible responses. You want to use those as designated in the interview. And unlike I'm doing right now, speaking at the speed of light, you would want to read the questions slowly because that will facilitate participant understanding. So you ask these questions exactly as written. You break them into smaller parts. You follow all the instructions to a T. And what if the person still doesn't understand the question that you're asking? Well, you can do some clarifications in a fully structured interview. Again, repeating the question exactly as written. This can get a little frustrating, but you can just repeat a specific part of the question, where you feel the person may not be understanding. again, emphasize any words that might help clarify the meaning of the question. Also, many structured interviews have certain response options, you know, few, many, once a week, twice a week, every day. If you're repeating a response option, you would need to repeat them all to make sure the person has the opportunity to hear all of the options again. But make sure that you're not rephrasing the question. Use the introductions. And also, if a person doesn't know what something means, you have to say whatever that means to you. You are not to be giving explanations of things in a fully structured interview. We want the person to make their own judgment. So this goes back to good listening. Make sure that you understand their answers. You want to verify information. Like we were talking about before, if somebody gives you information earlier in the interview, be ready to verify that later. And also you can use probes. And I mentioned something about using neutral probes. And here are neutral probes, and specifically on the CD. So I'm using the CD as an example because it is the most used structured interview in the CTN. And some people are still trained in it. And so these are some neutral probes that you can use on the CD. And these are kind of CD-sanctioned neutral probes. But these are great probes to have in your kind of toolkit as an interviewer, because these are just fantastic open-ended questions to elicit more information to get the information you need to code a response and collect the data. The abbreviations in brackets at the beginning of those probes, those are all indicators of what probe you use. So if you're doing the CD and you ask a neutral probe, you would note which one you use, so that's really for supervision, so your supervisor knows that you're playing the right game and using your neutral probes. But this is a great list of probes to use, like I said, not only for the CD, but for any kind of interview that you do to elicit information from participants. Also, in a fully structured interview, we give feedback to the person as they're answering the response, because it can feel a little, well, it is constrained. So we want to give people feedback, and this is to reinforce their attentive behavior, to keep them motivated, to continue the interview. Silence can be a form of feedback, but things like thank you, or that's just what I was looking for, we're really staying on task, let's keep going. Those kinds of things you can say in a fully structured interview that are just motivating and encouraging for the participant. So for people who are not CD trained and have not seen a fully structured interview, some of this might seem sound a little foreign, but you may come in contact with or be required to conduct some fully structured interviews, and so you'll be more prepared to do so and know what to expect. So at this point, let's see if there's any questions about fully structured interviews, comments from CD interviewers who love doing it, who miss doing it. Anything is relevant. I'm a CD trainer. I like the CD.
Once again, that's star one if you have a question or comment at this time.
Anything about fully structured interviews?
And there are no questions or comments coming in the queue at this time.
Okay, too structured. So let's
move on. We just did have one that queued up. Davina Jones.
Hi, Davina.
Hi, Gloria. Although I must admit the CD is not one of my very favorites, it can definitely be a challenge with people whose education level isn't very high. What I always suggest is just to be extremely patient. Whenever I was going to begin a CD, I always made sure to really prepare the client, so that they knew what to expect. They knew that I was going to be asking as is, and just do what you can to be, supportive of their needs. I remember also I was an interviewer on a game study which is another structured instrument, and working with adolescents, and that was a lot more challenging.
Oh, I bet.
Because, you know, if they didn't understand something, and all you have is the probes and the exact wording, so it, you know, it's just a matter of really catching the catch words in there so that they can understand, and relying on the probes and the cue cards that they give you to use with those structured instruments.
Yeah, exactly. So really knowing those words that emphasize the meaning and being able to repeat those, and you know, I think I didn't give enough attention to the importance of introducing the interview, especially with the fully structured interview, because it is odd, and people are looking at you like, why do you keep asking me the same question all the time? And so there's a preparation for the CD in particular, and some instructions that you give to the person. You let them know that this is the way this interview goes, and this is the way I have to ask the questions, and, you know, bear with me. And so I think, you know, asking the questions slowly, being able to break them up into smaller pieces, knowing the intention and what words to emphasize, and preparing the person well, those are all great suggestions and reminders. So thank you.
And there are no other questions in queue at this time.
Okay, thank you. So we'll move on to semi-structured interviews. And these are probably more familiar to most of the people on the call. And here's a list of some of the semi-structured interviews that we commonly use in our CTN assessment batteries. We've got the ASI, the timeline follow-back, the DSM-IV checklist, the RBS. And if you think about these interviews, sometimes there's a question that you can ask, and sometimes there's just a concept that's listed, you know, frequency of substance use, or you know, there's something that you need to fill in, but there may not be the exact probe, and these are semi-structured interviews. There's often an initial or base question that you would read as written. And then oftentimes in a semi-structured interview, there might be suggested follow-up probes to clarify a participant response. Those usually appear in parentheses. And then there are different types of data that are collected in semi-structured interviews. Like in the ASI, we ask how troubled or bothered were you by a specific behavior, or how many drinks did you drink? So there's different types of data that you collect in a semi-structured interview, and really not that much different than what you would collect in a fully structured interview. But basically, you have a lot more leeway to ask follow-up questions to get the information you need. So I just pulled this out of the ASI manual because I think it addresses some of the core issues of doing a semi-structured interview. So here the interviewer is responsible for the integrity of the information collected and must be willing to repeat, paraphrase, and probe until satisfied that the patient understands the question and that the answer reflects the best judgment of the patient consistent with the intent of the question. So again, there's a lot more leeway here. You're probing, you're repeating, you're paraphrasing, you know, you're cajoling, you're doing whatever you can, but the most important thing is to meet the intent of the question. So knowing what you're asking and making sure that you ask enough questions to be able to answer the question of interest. So when thinking about the question's intent, if you're doing, for example, a diagnostic interview, what is the criterion being assessed? So is it the dependence criterion of loss of control over over their substance use? Is it an abuse criterion, driving under the influence? Is it something about impairments in work functioning? And would that be an abuse or a dependence criterion? So you need to be really clear what you're asking. What is the problem being evaluated? This is more consistent with the ASI. And what scale is being used? You know, you've got the RBS that asks about the frequency of the information or of behaviors of high-risk sexual behaviors. How often did that happen? With how many partners? Sometimes you're answering absolute numbers. Sometimes you're using a scale. So you have to be really clear about all of those things when you're asking those questions. And We talked a little bit about the follow-up probes, the neutral follow-up probes in the CD, but follow-up probes are even more important in semi-structured interviews, again, to reflect the intent of the question to collect the data. This could be nonverbal or verbal, because you could give somebody a look or you could be quiet and be eliciting more response. You can ask long probes or short probes. Can you tell me more about that? Or asking a more specific question that might be more lengthy. And again, those neutral probes really are your friend. And I always recommend to people either having a laminated copy of that around or having a copy of those probes in an interviewer binder so that you get really, or even committing them to memory, so you're really familiar with those kinds of open-ended probes that are going to help you elicit the information you need. So what are some problems that people have in probing? Well, oftentimes it's that you fail to realize that you need to do a follow-up probe. And that goes back to listening, that you think that the information that they've given is enough to code an answer, and you didn't ask enough questions. I think probably many interviewers have gotten in the situation where their supervisor has asked them to call the participant and ask them the question again or ask some follow-up questions to get the data. I know that was something that has come up a lot in the trials that I've worked on. So that's one of the common errors, is just not probing enough. And then, of course, on the other end of the spectrum, probing too much, not realizing that you've got the information you need and continuing on that path, I think that's a little less common of an error. And then, as we mentioned a little bit before, asking leading questions. And that can be, again, kind of non-verbally. You can, cast some judgments with your face, definitely communicate some bias, or asking verbally leading questions. And we want to avoid leading questions. So I'm just going to go on to qualitative interviews because they have some similarities with semi-structured interviews. And we use qualitative interviews to collect more in-depth and attitude-driven responses from participants in a study. Often they are semi-structured because there are initial probes to standardize the information we're collecting. And also it helps us understand quantitative results. So we get some data and we get interview information from people who give us the data, and we're able to understand our data better. So there have been a number of studies in the CTN that have used qualitative interviews. In CTN 18 and 19, the Safer Sex for Men and for Women, we interviewed clinicians who participated in the study, clinicians who did not participate in the study, and then administrators and directors to look at the potential sustainability of the intervention after the research was over. So what was the response to research, and how did they foresee that they might use our interventions after the research was done and after we left the clinic? That's a great way to use qualitative interviews. Now for CTN 44, we have an ancillary study in Native American communities, and we're going to be talking to the clients who do the web-based intervention and ask them how relevant it was to their culture. So we want to do in-depth interviews with them. Focus groups are qualitative. Focus groups are like in-depth interviews. And so those are all ways of collecting kind of more rich data that can inform the more quantitative results that we get from our trials. And a good interview, a good qualitative interview really ends up being just like a conversation. And again, you have to be familiar with the questions and the intent of the questions. And here, as opposed to any of the other interviewing we're talking about, interviewers really need to allow for longer responses, letting people talk about their experiences, because that's, as people talk and as they get more comfortable, that's where we end up getting some of the more valuable information, as people get kind of loosened up and allow them to give longer responses. So we don't want to redirect them back to the question, because we might get more rich and deep information by letting them give some longer responses. You would want to use your judgment on that, but it's different than a semi-structured interview where you would want to pull a person back and redirect them to the intent of the question. You want to allow for more pauses and reflections without rushing. And here, again, because it's less structured, you want to be very aware of possible biases or judgments that might get communicated in the questions you're asking, and then refrain from too much self-disclosure, of course. There we go. Like the slide about your two ears and your one mouth, there are times when silence is golden, and we need to be comfortable enough to wait for somebody to think something through, to not rush people. Sometimes silence can be uncomfortable, and we need to be aware of our own comfort with silence, because some people are much more comfortable with it than others and are more willing to sit and wait for somebody to respond. And in a qualitative interview situation, we want to give the participant more space to think about things and to speak at their own pace. So these are just some follow-up probes that you might use in a qualitative interview. Some of them are very similar to the neutral probes, but we want to really get more, deeper with people about, can they be more specific? If you're talking about what they would want to change in an intervention, what else would you change? That's just encouraging more examples. So somebody says, well, I would change those videos that I couldn't relate to the videos. What would you change about the videos? Anything else? Anything else? But the more you ask anything else, the more you might come up with more examples of what you're looking for. And again, asking for specifics and examples can open people up to giving you more information. And in all kinds of interviews, but especially these types, you want to really avoid asking why. Because why questions imply that there's some kind of reason or cause that somebody should know. And it kind of puts somebody on the spot. Well, why? Why did you do that? And so it can be feel a little judgmental, like you're really putting somebody on the spot. Motives are complicated. When you're asking why, it's like, what was your motivation? Why did you do that? Well, that's complicated. And that's, like I said, putting somebody on the spot. And it also can suggest that maybe you don't believe what a person's telling you. So in general, when asking questions, this really goes across the board, try to avoid those why questions as much as possible, because they end up not getting you the information that you need. All right, so we're going to play one more little game and see if you can come up with what's the follow-up probe to the response that a person might give on an interview. So if you ask, how did you like the intervention, or how did you like that session, and somebody says, it was boring, well, what might you use as a follow-up probe to it was boring? So we'll open up the phone line, *1, if you have a good follow-up probe for that.
We'll go to first to Davina Jones.
Great.
I would ask him, what was it you found to be boring?
Terrific. So you're asking what specifically, and you're using that person's word also. Yeah, absolutely. So what was it you found to be boring? Thank you. Any other possible follow-up probes?
We'll go next to Thomas Hill.
I was doing it, stole my thunder. I was going to say the exact same thing.
Great minds think alike. Excellent.
And we have Denise Allen.
Denise?
I would say something like helping to understand what you felt was boring about the question.
Okay. Help me to understand. That's good. You're in this together. Okay. Help me to understand what was boring. Great. I have a couple more, but any others for the boring probe?
That's it for that one.
Okay. I liked it. What would you follow up with for I liked it?
We'll go first to Thomas Hill.
What specifically did you like about it?
All right, Thomas, you got your shot. Thomas was ready. He had the keypad in hand. Exactly. What specifically did you like about it? Say, oh, well, I really liked how they understood me.
We'll go next to Denise Allen.
Hi, Denise.
Hi. Thomas somewhat stole my thunder, but I'll just kind of rephrase that. Help me to understand, or would you share with me what you liked about it?
Denise, I like your collaborative spirit in your follow-up probes. That's great.
Thank you.
That's great. All right, and one more. I don't know. Well, what do you say to that?
And we have go to Lynn Calvin.
I would ask, is there anything that you could think of?
Okay. Okay, great. Is there anything you could think of? Very good. How about others?
Denise Allen.
I would try to clarify any misunderstanding by asking, is there something that you don't understand?
Okay, and how, so is there something that you don't understand?
Which is prompting her uncertainty about not knowing.
So one thing, you could always ask the question again, or maybe paraphrase the question to try to make it more comprehensible, potentially.
Exactly. That's
yeah.
What I mean. Mm-hmm.
Great, great.
And we also have Mark Vasquez.
Hi, Mark.
Oh, we just covered it. She just said it.
Okay, great. Well, you guys all have such fantastic ideas. I love that. See, oh, we're already reliable. See, that reliability is what we strive for as interviewers. So that's great. That's great. All right, so those are some of the kinds of probes that you would use to follow up on these kind of dead-end responses that you could get from a participant. And you guys are ready, so that's awesome. So what are we going to do next? What are our next steps? I didn't put it down here. Go back and look at your SOPs for those emergency situations, right? But what are the best ways to sharpen your skills and keep them sharp? Well, first and foremost really is to practice, to be really well-versed in the interviewing procedures that you're conducting in any study that you're doing. And, the training procedures in the CTN have become a little less structured than they've been in the past, but I think at most sites people are, getting the training and the follow-up, supervision, tape review, all those things can really help you sharpen your skills as an interviewer. We definitely like to do role plays of interviews and procedures, and to do that on occasion throughout a study. We tend to spend a lot of time before we start a study role playing and practicing, and it's good to maybe do some of those practice procedures 3 months in, 6 months in, just again to keep those skills sharp. Get supervision when you can. There are people at your sites and research staff who've been around for a long time. I don't know, longer than me, but they've been around for a long time. And those kinds of people and your peers can all help you with supervision. If you can do reliability checks, and this is a thing that's kind of gone by the wayside, but two people coding the same interview data and then seeing if your answers are the same. We used to do that in a more systematic way. We don't anymore, but if you're able to do that at your site, that can really give you some good ideas about where you might be going astray, where you could improve some of your skills, and also what you're doing well. And always feel free to ask questions of the staff, and if people want to contact me about questions, I'm always happy to answer them if I know, or connect you with the right person to talk to about different assessments. But you have a lot of resources within your node. We have a lot of resources in the CTN. Liz is a great resource. She knows who the go-to people are. So if you have any questions about specific procedures, specific assessments, or interviewing guidelines, then definitely ask some questions and get that information. And we said it was going to be 2 hours. It's a little less than that. It's that rule of thumb that I think Christy talked about. You tell them it's going to take a little longer, and then if it doesn't, everybody's happy. But with that, if there's any other questions or comments, we can end on that note. If people have other questions, we'll certainly take some time.
Once again, if you have a question or a comment at this time, please press star then one. And we do have one from Thomas Hill.
Right. I just have a comment. I just want to say that this was very informative, and I really appreciate it.
Well, thank you, Thomas.
You did a great job.
Thank you, and I really appreciated the active participation of many of you on the call. Thank you.
We have also Denise Allen.
Denise.
Okay. I just have one short question, if you could just answer that, or just give me an example of in the semi-structured interviews, can you give me an example of the timeline follow back commonly used? CTN.
Sure. The timeline follow back, and actually, there's an excellent training that Amy Campbell just did last month, and there is a recording available with the webinar that you can watch to get sort of your introduction to the timeline follow back.
Okay.
But the timeline follow back is a calendar based assessment where you're looking day to day of a person's substance use on a daily basis for a specific amount of time. So you would look back, say, 30 days and work with a person to construct a calendar of the past 30 days, what were some milestones in the past 30 days that can help them recall with pretty good accuracy their drinking and drug use over a specific period of time. And then the use levels are coded in a calendar kind of format on a day-to-day basis.
Okay.
Yeah. So, but I would highly recommend taking a look at that. That's an hour-long webinar with an introduction to the timeline follow-back, role play, and some guidelines for administration.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Sure.
And there are no other questions in queue at this time.
Okay. Well, thanks, everybody. It was great.
Thanks very much, Gloria. If I could just take a second to let everybody know, especially Denise, if you're interested in getting recordings from past webinars, they're available on the CTN Dissemination Library as well as on LiveLink. Any questions regarding past presentations or future presentations can be directed to my attention, and that's ebuttry@ms.com or ctntraining@ms.com. Gloria, I can't thank you enough. It was a great presentation. Thanks, everybody, for joining. Have a great afternoon, everyone.
This concludes today's web conference. Thank you for your participation.